You know, Maya Angelou says the universe isn't made of atoms, it's made of stories, right? Narratives matter more to us. Role models are narratives, right? So I suddenly realized that this was the best classroom I have got to be an entrepreneur. So taking the long view is the really important part. You know, a 20-year plan is not 21-year plan. You know, life is a series of luck, skill, and choices. Choices matter more than abilities, but your choices will also reflect your hopes rather than your fears. And that's always not easy to do. So I found many years ago, I concluded that writing better and having great content was a really important part of what I viewed as my mission, which was to sort of make the case for India to change and obviously be an entrepreneur. Truly successful companies renew themselves all the time. So sometimes the people who brought you from 0 to 10 will not take you from 10 to 100. I don't look for the meaning of life. I look for meaning in life. Make yourself stronger. I mean, don't believe people who tell you that this is not possible, or, you know, you can't do this, or this can't be done. So I would say compounding is a really difficult insight. The human mind doesn't understand exponential growth.
Okay, so today we have with us Manish Sabharwal. Welcome, Manish.
Hi, hi. How are you doing?
So I'm very well. Manish is chairman and co-founder of TeamLease Services, one of India's leading staffing and human capital firms. TeamLease is also implementing India's first vocational university and national PPP apprenticeship program. And the company has hired 1.8 million employees over the last 15 years. And in 1996, Manish co-founded India Life, an HR outsourcing service, which was then acquired in 2002 by Hewitt Associates. Consequently, he was CEO of Hewitt Outsourcing Asia, based in Singapore for 2 years. So Manish is a member of the National Skill Commission, Central Advisory Board of Education, and has served on various policy committees for education, employment, and employability. And he has served as an independent director on the board of the Reserve Bank of India, RBI. He's a member of advisory board of the Comptroller and Auditor General, CAG, and a governing board member of National Council of Applied Economic Research, NCAER. He's also managing trustee of the New India Foundation that offers fellowships for writing books about post-1947 India. And he's a columnist for Indian Express. He got his MBA from the Wharton School and is alumnus of Sri Ram College, Delhi and Mayo College, Ajmer. So welcome, Manish, to this show.
Thank you.
And so as I told you, this show is focused more on learning through real life stories and kisse kahaniyas of your life. So give me a little bit about your personal life journey. These are, you know, solid business accomplishments and someone who understands policy economics so well. But give me a bit about your personal life journey.
I mean, I'm born and brought up in Kashmir. I'm a child of civil servants, which means I carry the gifts and wounds of a civil service upbringing. The gifts are substantial. You know, early in life, you realize that you don't live in an economy, you live in a society. Frugality is another very important gift as I reflect back of a civil service upbringing, which is always great for an entrepreneur. But obviously, some of the risks of wounds of a civil service upbringing can be risk aversion. You know, your parents want you to take a job. They don't really have this. But I got lucky. I went to boarding school. I went to Mayo. I went to Sri Ram College, Delhi. And then between Sri Ram and my MBA, I became executive assistant to the chairman of an Indian group in Hyderabad, which was a fantastic experience because he was setting up. And I always thought you needed to have money to start your own company. That's what my parents told me. I realized this guy was doing it with other people's money. So that was a great experience for 4 years. And then I went to Wharton for my MBA. And I went to Wharton with the idea that I would come back as an entrepreneur. So in 14 out of my 21 classes, I wrote my business plan. I came back in the summer. And I started a company called India Life with one of my roommates from Sri Ram College, Ashok Reddy. And we sold India Life. So in 96, I came back. We sold it to Hewitt in 2002. Then they sentenced me to 2 years in Singapore, which I hated. You know, king of a small kingdom is still king. So I served my sentence 2004. But we started Team Lees in 2002. Mm-hmm. And I came back in 2004 and then joined Ashok. And we did India Life together. We've done Team Lees together. So now it's 20 years of Team Lees. And we've also been 5 years as a listed company. So essentially from Kashmir till now has been, you know, one experience building on the other. And really, in my mind, a recognition, at least, I think when you grow up as a civil servant, in a civil servant household, the conversations are really different than if you grow up in a business household, right? And so early in life, I think I realized that there was really no contradiction between doing well and doing good. And you know, you really don't define success as being rich, thin, or good looking. You know, there are mighty sort of causes out there calling you, and it's clear. And especially given what my dad did in Kashmir, he was the director general of police during terrorism, and he's been shot at many times. And so I thought that, I mean, the life that they chose to live was an important inspiration for me in sort of how, even though I've chosen business, I choose to spend at least 30-40% of my time on broader costs.
So when you look at your life, what would be some of, what can be one of the key milestones for you as a leader? What would you call as one of the key milestones? There would be many.
I mean, I guess, yeah, the forks are the one fork was obviously going to Hyderabad, which set me on my route to business because I worked with an entrepreneur. And, you know, Maya Angelou says the universe isn't made of atoms, it's made of stories, right? Narratives matter more to us. Role models are narratives, right? So I suddenly realized that this was the best classroom I have got to be an entrepreneur. So I think going to Hyderabad as executive assistant to Nupinder Rao was an important milestone. Obviously, going to Wharton changed the size of my thoughts. I think if I had stayed back, then my companies may have been smaller than what they ended up being. But I quickly realized that it's the same damn headache to manage a 500 crore company as a 5 crore company. And you work as hard. Maybe you work probably harder as a 5 crore company because you can't afford to hire people. So I think that going to Hyderabad, going to Wharton, selling India Life, you know, starting Team Lees. And I'd say the 30% of my time, which I now spend on public policy, I think over the last 10 years, I think those are, it has convinced me that India's problems are not problems like cancer or climate change. They are plumbing problems, right? And we can do something about them. And I've always hated cultural explanations for India's poverty, because cultural explanations are at best the soft bigotry of low expectations, and at worst they are racism. And so it's almost, and I think the pandemic has sort of reinforced for me what other people are discovering, that, you know, India is a poor country. I mean, America's fiscal deficit this year is more than our GDP. India is a poor country, but it doesn't have to be. So hopefully that's what I have at least made my mission for the last 20 years, that education, employment, and employability are really at the heart of why we are poor. And this is not something that we can leave to the government. You know, Gandhiji said we must become the change we seek. And this is something that I think it's cumulative, right? I have reflected on it as a company, I've reflected it on as an industry, and now I reflect it hopefully in working Nation. With policymakers.
So, you know, give me a little more thoughts and ideas on the soil and roots behind this tree called Manish Sabharwal. So something you shared, what else? What else has been in the soil? What has made the tree strong? What are the inner thoughts and narratives which you have carried along?
I don't know. I think compounding to me, if I was to reflect back, I think the one thing I would like my kids to learn is compounding. Compounding in relationships, compounding in knowledge, compounding in relation, in fitness, compounding in money is obviously the easiest way, and compounding in building a company, right? I mean, most people, when I ask them this question, I'll give you 1 paisa doubling a day for a month, or I'll give you 10 lakh rupees now, which one will you take it? I go to business schools often, and most of the idiots in business school take the 10 lakhs. But 1 paisa doubling a day is 1 crore 6 lakhs. For 30 days, you know, 1 paisa, 2 paisa. But the till the 25th day, you're better off taking 10 lakhs.
Mm-hmm.
But in the last 5 days, you make 90 lakhs, right? And so that is the nature of knowledge, right? I've read a book a week for 25 years. I've written a column, two columns a month for 15 years now. And I think the power of compounding of knowledge is very powerful. I think relationships, you know, I mean, any relationship takes, you know, 2 decades to truly build up, right? And I'm proud of all the relationships that from school and college in Wharton, which have stayed cumulative for me. And of course, in building a company, you know, building a great company takes 30, 40 years. We are still a baby in diapers. We are only 20 years old. In my mind, we're just getting started. And of course, compounding in what you eat and your exercises. So I think most people think of compounding as sort of money, but I would say taking the long view is a really important part. You know, a 20-year plan is not 21-year plans. And it's very hard for people to sort of keep the faith for 20 years. But, you know, I think Ludo is a better game to play than snakes and ladders, right? You know, Ludo is more laborious. You know where you're going. You'll eventually get there. But snakes and ladders, most people don't realize the snakes are longer than the ladders, and they're more snakes than ladders when you count it on the board, right? And that's true of life. So I would frame, if I was to reflect back, as, you know, life is a series of luck, skill, and choices. I mean, there's no question that luck is very, very important. But, you know, when people ask me about luck, I say, well, I have a Calvin and Hobbes cartoon in my office where Calvin says the secret to success is being in the right place at the right time. Since you never know the right time, you find the right place and hang out, and he goes to sleep there. This is the right place, the right time, jab aega, wo aega. So I think people tend to build a little bit of their own luck, but there is a lot of luck in the world. I know a lot of people who are very lucky, but not skilled. And I know a lot of people who are skilled, but not lucky. But skill is very important. So obviously, there's a third dimension. And I think in the last few years, I've been reflecting on what Dumbledore tells Harry Potter in Chamber of Secrets, right? That it is our choices more than our abilities that reveal what we really are. Yeah. And I think that framing for me about people who are lucky and skilled, but you need to make good choices, right? You know, lots of skilled people who make crappy choices, and you know how to not so skilled people who make good choices, right? Choices are not in the realm of skill. I think they are in terms of thinking holistically about situations. And most of our choices, whether strategy, whether relationships, these are adaptive problems, right? Most engineers like you are good at technical problems. You know, there's the right answer. And technical problems are what we deal with earlier in our life and earlier in our career. But as you go advanced in your career, most problems have 4 right answers. And you have to choose between them, right? And that is what an adaptive problem. And that's where choices, I think, come in place. You know, Robin Hoggart, one of my favorite psychologists, talks about kind learning environments and wicked learning environments. You know, in kind learning environments, the goals are fixed, the players are fixed, the rules are fixed, and feedback is immediate and it is usually accurate. You know, in wicked learning environments, the rules keep changing, the people keep changing, the goal keeps changing, and feedback is very delayed and it's often inaccurate, right? So when you get when you start running a company as a chief executive, it's a wicked learning environment, right? And so I think that it's a challenge, and choices are what decide whether you succeed in a wicked learning environment: values, character, strength, and obviously your strength. You know, one of my favorite quotes of all times is Rambhari Singh Dinkar. You know, he's one of my favorite Hindi poets. He says, "Shama shobhti us bhujang ko jiske paas garal ho." Right, only snakes who have venom can be benevolent or kind or generous, right? I mean, it's essentially a case for being, it's only a case for being strong, right? It's sort of like Iqbal's khudi, right? Khud ko buland kar itna ki khuda bande se khud poochhe bajate hi raza kya hai. So I think that for me, looking back, as I frame, I have had a lot of luck. I chose my parents wisely. I chose my pin code wisely. I have obviously got a Wharton MBA, which I've used. But hopefully I'm getting better at making choices. I've made a lot of crappy choices over the years. But, you know, the only, you know, good judgment comes from experience, and experience comes from bad judgment, right? So it's just that simple. So essentially, if you think about, And I think hopefully as you get older, everybody will make mistakes, but your choices should reflect your hopes rather than your fears. Right? I mean, it's very important. So choices matter more than abilities, but your choices will also reflect your hopes rather than your fears. And that's always not easy to do. So it, but I think, you know, I am my ancestors' wildest dreams, right? if I think about ancestors, great grandparents, grandparents. I mean, to have hired somebody every 5 minutes for the last, they were all educators, and even my dad before he became a civil servant was a professor. My grandfather was a professor before that, and I think that for them, you know, we've hired somebody every 5 minutes for the last 15 years. And wow. I think an education and a life and a job changes lives in ways that nothing else can. I mean, they can take anything away from you. They can't take away your education, right? in any situation in the world. So I think that, you know, the choices, skills and luck framing is really, as I look back when I try to sort of think about what has worked, luck has obviously been important, but choices. I mean, I think that I was gifted with a bunch of role models who asked me to take the long view, to not be in a hurry, you know, to take the long view that, you know, life is long. It's a marathon. Don't run it at the speed of a 100-meter dash. You won't finish it, or you won't finish it well. And India's problems are really big. And if you really want to make a contribution, you need to be strategic and take the long view. So I think, to me, the three most interesting questions, which are going to be a lifetime quest, which really animates who I am, is why are some countries poor? Why do some companies grow and some companies stay small? You know, my baby versus dwarf framework. As an entrepreneur, there are two kinds of companies. You can start a baby and a dwarf, but the baby is going to grow and the dwarf is going to stay there. My first company was a dwarf. India Life was a 50, 75 crore company in 5 years. Team Lease is 6,000, 5,000 crores this year. And why do some people who show promise with skills not make great CEOs or make good general managers, right? So the difference between skills and choices, right? And I think this is true. All three questions have a very similar binding constraint. You know, in countries, they talk about the middle income trap, right? In companies, you talk about the, you know, 100 crore, 50 crore threshold, which many companies are not able to go. And I know lots of people around me who were great general managers, but they didn't make great CEOs. And so to me, it's the X factor in these situations, which is not all science. Some of it is art, some of it is synthesis more than analysis.
I have this question that, you know, what has really driven you? What kind of values you have lived with? What is your core, you know, leadership philosophy? And, you know, what is the source of all of those values and philosophy?
I mean, I think, though it's from, you know, it's, whether it's in the Bible or this, to those who much is given, much is expected, right? I mean, we are also lucky in where we are today that if we don't use our abilities to give back, I mean, people wrapped up in themselves make small packets, right? That's always been true. And so I think that, you know, thinking about where India is and how to sort of take it to the next level, and just a belief that what you do matters, right? See, there are two views of history. One is the social science view of history and one is the literature view of history. The social science view of history says people don't matter. It's all about circumstances, right? These are like Karl Marx or Romila Thapard. And the literature view of history is people like Carlyle or Ram Guha who say that the history of the world is the biography of great leaders, right? I mean, so the social science view of history says India became independent because the British were bankrupt and tired after World War II. But the literature view of history says, hold on. I mean, from 1885 to 1915, the National Congress was petitioning the British for independence. But in 1915, Gandhiji came back. In 1917, there was Champaran. 1919, there was Bardoli. 1921, there was civil disobedience. 1929, there was the Purna Swaraj resolution. 1932, there was the round table. In 1942, there was the Quit India movement. In 1947, we got free. So it took 30 years, but in the end, human efforts do matter. And I think for me, the, at least, that is a fundamental view of the world, that what you do matters. You know, I mean, if it's if everything is written, then what's the point of showing up to work? So I think, you know, I have this strong belief that we are not the waiter, we are the chef. You know, we are not river rafting, we are a motorboat. And if you don't develop human agency or demonstrate human agency, you'll never be lucky. And of course, luck is very important. So I think the 21st century forms of intelligence are serendipity intelligence, conversational intelligence, and team intelligence, right? Serendipity intelligence is how do you get more lucky? Conversational intelligence is how you say something is more important than what you're saying. And team intelligence is just recognition you can never do big things alone. So I would say that these are really the what I believe should be, we should be teaching people, or we should be learning ourselves. And it, you know, you never really learn it. I'm not always good at all these three forms of intelligence, but hopefully I'm getting better once I've recognized it.
Okay. So one, let me take you back to your childhood with with all that you explained. What would you consider in hindsight as your biggest childhood challenge?
Oh, all kinds of weight was my challenge. Studies was my challenge. Concentration was my challenge. I was not a great student till I was a late bloomer, you know, and I did my highest marks I ever got was in class 12, thankfully, because that got me into Shriram College. India tends to be a hit or miss system, which is why I fight a lot with the Singapore government, because they have a system of streaming. In eighth class, if you're not good, they say you can't go to college, you go to vocational training. I said, mujhe bhej dete yaar, if I was, you know, late bloomers have a problem. So I think I had lots of I went to boarding school. So I was overweight. I didn't have the best grades. I wasn't great at this, but you know, something snapped around 11th and 12th grade, where I snapped out of it. I lost my weight. I studied and I went to Shriram College. So in a boarding school, you can imagine an overweight guy who's not good at sports and is not good at studies can have lots of challenges.
Would you be able to go back to the time? What could have snapped? When you said between 10th, 11th, 12th, something shifted.
I've thought of that. I've never been able to pinpoint it. It might be role models. It might just be a deadline that if you don't snap out of it, you know, you're not going to get into Shriram College, which is what I had set my heart on. So I have no idea. There wasn't anything sort of special about those times. I was always fond of reading, and maybe it was a book, maybe it was something else. I mean, I've been reading since I was a child, and I've, you know, read a book a week, as I told you, for 25 years. So I suspect it was probably some book, but I don't know. It's hard to pinpoint.
So I watched many of your interviews. So you can reel out numbers. You have, you know, great connection with numbers, accurate numbers and history. So from where did this come from? Did you develop it? Did it automatically come? Did it was linked to reading books? Where would you say this knack of remembering numbers, relevant numbers?
I don't think it's a knack. I think it's a skill. And I think it's a skill that I have cultivated because I recognized early in life that I was going to be making arguments for change. And in public policy, the messenger is more important than the message. You know, it doesn't matter what's being said because everything has already been said before. It's who is saying it and how are you connecting the dots. So I found many years ago, I concluded that writing better and having great content was a really important part of what I viewed as my mission, which was to sort of make the case for India to change and obviously be an entrepreneur. So I started writing columns. I started my first column in Business India 20 years ago. Thankfully, they are not online because they were crappy columns. but now I'm writing my 450th column and it's very good. So when people ask me, how do you write so well? I said, well, write 449 ones before this, right? That's how you get better at doing something. So I think compounding again, right, as a skill set. So I think that I had concluded that being a good writer and knowing India well, and I spend a lot of time trying to understand India well. I read 8 newspapers a day. I keep up with all the statistics of this country to triangulate and connect how urbanization is linked to labor markets, which is linked to financialization, which is linked to farming, which is linked to labor laws, which is linked to ITIs, which is linked to apprenticeships. You know, I mean, one of my favorite books is Consilience by E.O. Wilson, where everything is connected, right? That's what consilience means. And I think that, to me, India's problems are not because of one thing. They're because of everything connected, right? So you have to make that shift from classical physics to quantum physics, right? Classical physics is discrete systems, while quantum physics, everything is connected. So I think I concluded many years ago that to make the case for change, Keynes was right. It is all about ideas. I know many people in India think change is blocked by vested interests. But the only way you can overcome vested interests is by ideas. Ideas are the most powerful thing. And an idea whose time has come is even more powerful than an idea. And so I think that I consciously spend time cultivating, and I have to keep renewing it. I mean, that's why I keep up with a lot of reading, essentially. I mean, I spend 50% of my time reading.
So I can see, imagine if I was viewing life through your mind, I can actually imagine as if there's a big dashboard with lot of events and everything being connected at a very, very deep level of understanding. And you keep refining this whole worldview. And probably you have to also realize that there are multiple level of depths you need to know on each. So if any part is big deeper, it will not hit a wall. It will hit a strong argument or a logic. So I can visualize that as I'm talking to you. So next question is, you know, what would be what would be one or two key events which made Manish who he is? Any stories there?
That's hard to say. Life is not the coming of a bulb. It is a gentle sunrise, no? And it is not, the bulb doesn't go on. I mean, I know all of us are screwed by Archimedes jumping out of a bathtub saying Eureka, but actually that's not how innovation happens also. Now we are realizing as we're unpacking innovation. So my sense is, I think my childhood in Kashmir, where I realized we don't live in an economy, and Kashmir is a complicated place, and being the son of the first police officer in India, IPS officer allocated to Kashmir, gave me a specific point of view. I think going to a boarding school gave me a certain point of view. I think being an executive assistant to an entrepreneur in the license Raj, when you know all that mattered was Delhi, that was also not a great system. So I'd say it's hard to point out simple events, but the fact that I went to Wharton, that really did change the size of my thoughts. I think I went for an MBA, and I came back with really a broad policy, business, and an economic education, I would say. You know, I had originally planned to just punch my ticket and come back. But I think I came back with a broad education, which really became the basis for thinking about companies. I don't have ever thought of a company as shareholders, you know, this stakeholder capitalism, which everybody considers fashionable. I think it was always stakeholder capitalism, right? I mean, businessmen are not money-grubbing people who don't know how to think about anything other than their companies. That's an unfair characterization. It's like saying every politician is corrupt or every bureaucrat is incompetent. I don't agree with that. And so I think that entrepreneurs in India after the 1955 Awadhi resolution and the 1956 second five-year plan were vilified. They were kneecapped. They were not given the freedom that they should have been. But I think the next 20, 25 years, entrepreneurs are an important part of solving India's problems. And especially post-COVID, I think people have realized that entrepreneurs will be an important part of the solution. So I'd say that if there was one thing, it was Wharton, which convinced me that I could do a company and still be a cause.
So the next question probably you already answered that. What was the... Or would you call something else as a turning point of your life? Because, you know, I think in Wharton, as you said, your perspective, I think your thinking level got at least 100x is what my sense is. And probably you went beyond just being an entrepreneur to contributing to the nation. You know, so some Anything else which you will consider
See,
as a turning point?
My challenge with your question is I don't believe learning is episodic. You know, the 25 years of learning, 25 years of earning, and 25 years of retirement.
So in the compounding, I am not asking
you
where the lottery.
last 5 years of RBI board meetings have been the best finance classroom I've ever been in. You know, going through the IPO process of Team Lees exposed me to how investors think about companies. My involvement on the investment committee and board of Gaja Capital, which exposes me to lots of other companies, right? So I have setting up Neve, which is one of India's best international schools with my wife, which we have done, has also been. So I think that the multiple avatars or the portfolio life that I chose to put together has really been cumulative. And so it's hard for me to sort of say, and it's still WIP. I mean, I think that each one of my avatars, I can do better, I can be stronger, I can get. But I'm starting to sort of narrow down on the 4 or 5 things that I will be doing for the rest of my life. Right? Team Lees is my life's work. We could have sold it to multinational wanted to buy us. But me and Ashok sat down and we said, look, we're never going to get an idea of this scale and impact in our lifetime again. You know, lightning doesn't strike in the same place twice. And so we've decided Team Lees will be our life's work, but that doesn't mean we'll be running it, right? I mean, most traditional entrepreneurs believe their shareholder role, their board member role, and their chief executive role is concurrent and guaranteed. In my mind, all those three roles are different, right? And because as a shareholder, you're focused on wealth. As a board member, you're focused on the next quarter century and quarter by being balanced, right? And as a chief executive, you know, Jonas Salk, he was the inventor of the polio vaccine. During the pandemic, I've been thinking a lot about a question he asked. You know, he said the most important question to ask is, are you being a good ancestor? I think it's a really interesting question, right? Because in the pandemic, we are tempted to steal from our grandchildren, saying we have problems right now. Let's just borrow government debt. And I mean, government debt at the end of the pandemic will be 90% of GDP. It used to be 70% So, and essentially, we're stealing from our grandchildren, right? Government, we're not going to repay this government debt in our lifetimes. So I'd say in building a company I have learned that you have to balance today and tomorrow. You know, how do you think about sustainability in your life? How do you think about sustainability of institutions? So this balancing the next quarter and next quarter century is a really important part of, I'd say, my learning. And which is still, there always is a conflict, right? Between today and tomorrow. You can maximize today when screw tomorrow. You can say, all right, tomorrow will be so great. Let's forget about today. Neither really works out, right? You have to learn how to balance it.
So coming back to conflict itself, what would you consider as one of the difficult conflict you faced and how did you tackle it?
I think just our first venture into vocational training, IIJT, we lost 100 crores. I was quite determined to continue it. I own 20% less of my company because of that mistake. But I think I learned, and I would have probably gone on if my board hadn't stopped me, but I'm grateful that they did stop me because I was glad that they chose to sort of cut it off at that point. But then I realized that, you know, a leader is a dealer in hope, but hope is not a strategy. You know what I mean? You have to be a dealer in hope. You always have to be optimistic, but hope is not a strategy. So I think that recognition that something that I was so clear and so confident about, and obviously that led to other things. It's led to our university. It's led to morphing into an apprenticeship program. So it was not all a write-off, but it was quite difficult.
Would there be anything else that you consider as a failure or a setback or a rejection that you turned around?
I mean, there are no failures, there are only learnings. No, if it doesn't kill you, it makes you stronger, right? I mean, see, entrepreneurship is the art of staying alive long enough to get lucky. How do you get lucky? You buy time. How do you buy time? You be frugal with capital. At least that's my simple equation, right? And so we have tried to stay frugal with capital, which is why 20 years have elapsed and we are just getting started, because I knew that, you know, Team Lees would require, had external constraints. The environment was a constraint on us, labor laws, regulatory cholesterol and stuff like that. So our strategy had to really say that, look, you can't build a strategy for 5 years. You have to take the long view here. and be patient and be persistent and be sort of strategic about this. You know, Leo Tolstoy in War and Peace says the two most powerful warriors are time and patience, and I totally agree with him.
So what would you consider as one of the most difficult decisions or dilemma you've faced?
I mean, there are lots of difficult decisions. Yeah, getting rid of people who have been loyal to you but are not competent, you mm-hmm. know, shutting down businesses for external reasons, not the competence of people. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, running a business is hard. You know, you're not a family, you're a team, right? And a lot of people talk about companies as families, but truly successful companies renew themselves all the time. So sometimes the people who brought you from 0 to 10 will not take you from 10 to 100. But they have been loyal to you. And they are nice people. But, you know, so I think the biggest or most difficult decisions in building a large company are the people decisions. And especially the people decisions where they're good people, but they're not always competent.
Wow. So as you shared, there have been multiple turbulent times you have seen in life. What has kept you anchored, and what is the narrative in your head when you go through these times?
I think that people make a difference. Huh? I mean, I think that what you do matters, and your strategy has to be built for resilience only. I think in the high tide of the last 20 years, sometimes we forgot about resilience. But, you know, somebody who grew up in Kashmir, you see resilience being such an important part of people's lives, right? I mean, in being in those situations. So I think I just have always had the view that India was a 10 horsepower engine running on 2 horsepower. India was poor not because of the British. It was in 1947. But in 2021, it is poor because of what we have done since 1947. Mm. You know, China and India had the same per capita GDP in 1991. Now they're 5 times more than us. And if anything, the pandemic has made us realize that we may be 5th in the world in GDP, but we are 138th in per capita GDP. So if we want India to be strong, I think what has kept me grounded is that we can be strong. But we have to change what we do. We have to change our institutions. We have to change. And it is possible to get change. I have over the last 20 years realized that it is possible to change India. So I'm hoping, however tragic this COVID has been, it will open up our minds to more ambition. It will open up our mind to being a more bold in our changes, because we are being held back by ourselves, not by others.
Very, very profound. Maybe it will push us out of the comfort zone as a nation, probably.
It's a cynical view that India doesn't change for a better option. She changes when you have no option. But maybe that's true for human beings also, right? No, we don't usually lose weight or quit smoking till you have a heart attack. So what to do? I mean, it's human beings are cracked vessels, and societies are just aggregation of human beings, right? So I think that change is a complex process. India has a complex history, but I don't think that China's 5 times more per capita GDP is cultural. I mean, they chose to break away from the centuries of poverty that have oppressed. Gandhiji used to say, you know, poverty is the worst form of violence, and I completely agree. So I think at the end of the pandemic, we have to recognize that our ability to handle the pandemic has been limited by our resources. And so there was a wonderful book about China, and where he chronicled Orwell and Shell, 20 philosophers over the last 200 years, and they obsess about wealth and power. Okay. It's interesting. If you wrote a book about India with the 20 philosophers, it wouldn't be about wealth and power. But I think it should be. I think it's, you know, it's hard to be religious on an empty stomach. It's hard to tackle COVID with a per capita of $2,000.
Okay, so last few questions. What is an unusual or an absurd activity or hobby that you love?
I mean, I used to love horse riding till a few years ago. I got a slip disc, and because of that, I'm no longer able to ride. But I would ride very regularly, sometimes almost every day. And I think that is partly growing up in Kashmir. But unfortunately, you know, horses are off limits for me now. But horses are some of the most amazing animals in the world.
So is there any other ritual? You said reading one book a week for sure. Is there any other ritual that you have followed over the years that has helped you in this compounding?
Just holding myself to account. I think setting goals, you know, if you don't have a dream, you can't have a dream come true. But a dream is a goal with a deadline. And to hold myself accountable on my weekly and monthly deadlines, I write a journal where I rewrite the entire journal, which has the monthly goals, quarterly, annual, long-term goals. And rewriting that every month helps me at least revisit and be honest with myself. You know, the most dangerous lies are the lies we tell ourselves, right, as individuals and as organizations. And I think, how do you call yourself out? How do you call the lies which you tell yourself about whether you're making progress, whether you have the time or you don't have the time, whether you have the skills or can build the skills or not? You know, to me, the growth mindset of Carol Dweck, you know, capabilities are not like shoe size or height, which are given. Capabilities are like muscles which can be developed with working out. So writing that journal every month and rewriting it forces me to be honest with myself on whether I'm making progress towards my goals.
What keeps you doing that? That is my deeper question, that doing that helps you. But what allows you, what has allowed you to stay on that course of
I think habit? a belief that what we do, it matters. A belief that India can change. A belief that we can be a better company. So the three questions are, why are countries poor? Why don't companies grow? And why don't some individuals be lifelong learners? It's enough to be it's a mystery. It's not a puzzle. You know, puzzles you can solve. Mysteries have something missing, right? And so I think mysteries are better. Puzzles you finish, then you have nothing left to do, right? But mysteries don't get solved. So I think a willingness to sort of that the universe is mysterious. I mean, we are only one out of 7 billion people, and you know, our planet is only one of 500 planets in the solar system, and it's 500 solar systems in the universe, and there are 2 trillion universes outside our universe. So I think it's clear that we are very small and we are very temporary here, right? So my sense is I don't look for the meaning of life. I look for meaning in life, right? So it was a long time ago. I mean, it's not something this is not a rehearsal, right, for something else. This is life. So I don't find it difficult to keep myself motivated to keep reading or keep exercising or keep writing or keep going to work. I mean, I find it just meaningful in its own self, I think.
Very interesting. I think you have mentioned so many statements that I'll have a tough time picking the best statement and giving it as a title for this interview. What are you now looking forward in life? You've done a lot of things. And so can you now show me that what you are looking forward quarter century?
I mean, I Daniel Kahneman, who got the Nobel Prize, in his book Thinking Fast, Slow, he wrote, the easiest way to increase your happiness is to take control of your time. Yes. And I think I always haven't had control of my time in the last 10, 20 years. In the next 10, 20 years, doesn't mean I'll work less hard, but I'll have more control of my time, more time to originate, more time to reflect, more time to nurture, which may be actually higher leverage than running around. You know, I took 260 flights in the 1 year before COVID. Yeah. So, I mean, I think maybe COVID is a recognition that, you know, now my job is migrating from doing to thinking to inspiring. And in my own role as an entrepreneur, 20 years, now it's time to give other people a job at a chance at bigger jobs in the company, right? You don't want to be a glass ceiling for people. And so my own role will morph sometime in the next few years from exec to non-exec. And then, I mean, I'll always be a shareholder. I'm not going anywhere, you know, but at least, and as a board member, it'll be more fun to ask the question, what was profit before tax last quarter, than to answer it, right? You know, today I answer the question. I'm looking forward to asking.
Okay, so the final question is, what advice would you give to a smart driven leader or an entrepreneur in making?
I mean, I think that, you know, Shama Shobati us bujang ko jiske paas garal ho. You know, only snakes who have venom can be kind and benevolent. Make yourself stronger. I mean, don't believe people who tell you that this is not possible, or, you know, you can't do this, or this can't be done. My sense is all of us in the long run, you know, all of us are, I think Oscar Wilde said it, all of us are in the gutter together, but some of us are looking at the stars. And, you know, everybody has a different life, and particularly it applies in COVID, right? So I think that, you know, the advice would be is that just keep getting better every day, compounding of relationships, compounding of your physical fitness, compounding of your knowledge, and compounding in building a company are really the seventh or eighth wonder of the world, whichever wonder we don't have right now. So I would say compounding is a really difficult insight. The human mind doesn't understand exponential growth. We are more used to linear sort of frameworks and linear, we understand. But, you know, 80% of the returns come in the last 20% of the time. Mm-hmm. You know, even though you make 80%, you know, it's the last 10% is always the hardest also, right? Deng Xiaoping used to tell people when they had completed 90% of the project, he said, well, good, now you have 50% of the work left, right? Because 50% of the work is the last 10%. So in various ways, my sense is compounding is a very important part of anybody's, any ambitious person's toolkit and mindset, and more importantly, it translates into patience and the willingness to be persistent, right? Because if you understand compounding, then you're willing to be more patient and persistent.
Wow. Okay. So I think this has been one very, very, you know, deep, full of insights and full of real life learning interview for me, as well as it would be for all the audience. And I'm really glad that, that, you know, Gopal suggested that you must talk to Manish and take this interview. So thank you very much for all your insights and for all your, you know, articulation. I really love the way it comes naturally to you. One can make out that someone who has read a lot, written a lot, and connected the dots.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here. Good luck and Godspeed.